Hello, good morning everyone. Thank you for having us. I'm Laura Todaro. I am a senior at Valdani & Vicari Associati, who had, I would say the privilege of executing this study for Aspen. It was a long study because I think it lasted for 2 years almost, and it regarded the impacts of refugees flows to territorial development in Europe. And today, if you can move to the next slide. Yes, I'll give some information about the study background. My colleague Matteo will explain some parts of the methodology as well as some findings from the study, and I will instead invest some of my time in telling you some example of good practices. Please go ahead. So the study, which was an applied research from Aspen, had the ambition of understanding the distribution of asylum seekers and refugees at a regional and urban level, and how which trend and how this was changing over time. And this proved to be slightly challenging because of the lack of some data, but as you will see, we somehow worked on this by triangulating several data sets. We tried to understand also the type of skill and qualification that the refugees possess and how they participate to the labor market and the type of impact that they could produce at local level. In this sense, we try to analyze also the type of policy responses that national and local, national, regional, local government try to elaborate to answer to the challenge in front of them. And so we analyzed good practices, one of which was also Sweden. And then we also try to understand the type of impact that, relocation scheme might have provoked throughout Europe, although this was highly linked with Dublin regulation. So we try to avoid to get into this, area that is more legalistic and remaining a bit more into the realm of policy responses at local level, while the Dublin issue is a bit more related to national policies. Please, you can move ahead. Of course, in this exercise, we were not alone. We had many more partners, for example, the Institute for Social Research in Milan, ICMPD in Austria, and many other colleagues, for example, the University of Leuven for the activity related to mapping. So the objective of the study was, as we said, support the development of a robust territorial evidence to inform policymakers in the field of migration. We were mainly dealing and analyzing a target group related to asylum seekers and refugees rather than the general migration migrants target group. But as I was saying before, data availability was not always there, so we studied also migrant data where it was needed. Our exercise was also large in scope when it came to the geographical area analyzed, because we had in front of us the EU 28 plus Iceland, Liechtenstein, Switzerland, Norway, as well as all of those countries that are considered the EU candidate countries. Of course, then to understand better in terms of explanatory factor the flows and the trends and the profiling of the refugees, we then used case study methodology, and we zoom in certain countries such as Italy, Sweden, Spain. You will see later the list of the regional cases. And with this, I give the floor to my colleague, Matteo.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you, everyone. Yes, so yeah, please, next slide. So basically, as said, we focus our analysis at the local, regional, let's say territorial level. I'm providing here a snapshot of the main findings emerging, and then of course you have much more details and nuances in the full report if you want to dig it into that. I think it's still available on EBSCO website. So we really started to from this overall impact chain. So if you look at the higher part of this chain, sorry, it's a bit small, but to give you a good flow of what we did. So we really started with assumption and looking at data on incoming, basically arrivals, both across the different country of origin, entering EU and the, yeah, you can see the full report on the web link. The incoming in Europe and the Balkans and other countries. And then we look really at this flow where people might stay in a place or move to other place, including potentially and very often becoming irregular. And then the second part of this flow on the bottom side is really when you look at the impact happening at the local level. And it's really an interplay, as was well introduced by the speakers of this session. It really builds on the interplay between features of the supply and feature of the demand. So feature of the incomers and feature of the local countries. And we see that this matching is much more a mismatch than a matching. And it's quite interesting to see what's the evidence that came in our analysis. So next slide, please. We look at the regional. We need to create some cluster because obviously we could not go, you know, region by region, and we create some ideal type group that were based on a work done by IRS, and we review quite a large number of indicators, and we pick quite a few, and we group regions based on like the pattern in growth, pattern in innovation to some extent, and local dynamics in each region. So we basically, if we exclude the red, the 7 and 8 cluster that you see in the map, we look at groups of very high growth region, like cluster 1 and 2, which are the greens that are mainly large capital regions, and then areas such Switzerland, as you can imagine, and then 2 and 3, so the blue and pale blue cluster, that are really kind of medium growing, stable, not big agglomerates, but kind of mid income regions, but very, very, you know, innovative and well performing. And then 5 and 6, which are, 3 and 4, which are also the purple, so the area is still innovative, but not super booming. And then 5 and 6, that are the yellow and kind of oranges, that are the area that are less innovative. You have a lot of exception within the region, of course, but comparing those to other region in Europe are those that have less of a dynamic labor market, for example. So we base on that, and it's interesting that already by doing that, we saw A, and you will see later, but you can also see this intuitively, those clusters kind of reflect the arrival, transition, and destination of regions. So it seems that migrants know where they want to go if you look at more appealing and innovative labor market. But also, as we see later on, next slide, please, they kind of reflect policy capacity and health, healthcare, health condition, as measured by the social progress index, for example, of the EU. So there are really these groups that are really distinct in their ability to provide jobs, but also provide basic shelter, health, and even advanced social policies. So next slide, please. So what did we find? That you could imagine. Some alert here I need to do. Don't get misled by the proximity of the bubbles, because that's more a reflection of the density of regions in a country rather than, but look at the size of a bubble. Then bubbles are not that different size, but you can see. And basically what you see here, if you keep in mind the previous cluster, is that a lot of density of like distribution is really between very few arrival destination regions and a number of arrival regions and a number of destination regions for migrants, which are mainly Northern Europe, Sweden, and Germany, as we know. And that's also kind of intuitively the case, but is actually confirmed by the data that we provide. But there's something a bit more interesting if we go ahead. So next slide, which reflects on the supply side, because not only how can I say, there's a sort of a distortion in the distribution of asylum seekers and refugees if you look at main characteristics, particularly when it comes to the social dynamics and the kind of skills. If you see the different colors in the chart on your left, they represent a distribution of origins in different countries. And okay, you don't have to go into all of that. Again, you can look at the report, but and we did it for the top five application countries. They kind of differ. So there's almost a distinct different composition. There's kind of a mix, different mix by different EU countries, if you look at the regions in those countries, that make a different type of origins, almost type of ethnicities in a way, you know, people from different origins tend to stay in different countries. And if you look at the charts on the right, you can also see that people from different origins, they tend to have different patterns and behaviors. So if you look at Syrians, the first quadrant on the top left, they're more distributed. This is all based on the labor force survey, I think. But they tend to be more heavily distributed across age, to some extent, certainly across gender, and is kind of more of a family group. And these are reflected in area like Germany, where a lot of Syrians go, and Germany tend to have the same average distribution of refugees and asylum seekers. So you have, that might imply that you have more stable patterns, people coming together, so different social pattern. If you look at the bottom side of the chart, Pakistan, but Nigeria is very similar. It's totally the opposite in a way. So there's a predominance of young adult men, typically alone, just trying to go and cope with it. And this is also reflected in some arrival destinations such as Italy. So that already gives a flavor of the very different social composition, the very different patterns of habits and potential willingness and characteristic of the arrivals. If you look at the next slide then, and this is even more interesting when it comes to the market labor, to labor market. And on the left side, I'm kind of done. On the left side, there is the difference between language and different cluster. And it varies, but it's not that clear the pattern. Whether if you look on the right side, it's very clear that the blue, which is a high skilled, really decrease from cluster to cluster. So the more you get to the less performing cluster, you also have less skilled people. And it's a kind of a lose-lose situation, because clearly it gets more complicated to employ those people in arrival. And it creates a struggle. And these are also areas where often they lack of proper policy capacity and experience. we did an overall analysis, and I'm done. And you see an overall result of this mismatch. So those regions clustered in the most competitive dynamic area, so cluster 1, 2, and 3, have on average a higher level of employment rate refugees and asylum seekers than other in less performing regions in Europe, cluster 4, 5, and 6. And also you see that the extreme difference are peaks, low and high are really very different. So it really, it has to do, as said in the introduction, it has to do like supporting full employability of refugees and asylum seekers. It has to do with the local capacity, but often it's more complex than that. And also maybe it's interesting to reflect at a more regional level the relation between different local policymakers and try to step up a bit from local policies to create a better capacity across Europe for local response. But I leave it for a few minutes to Laura for a reflection on good practice and recommendation. Thanks a lot. Next slide, I guess.
Yes, thank you. In essence, I think the other issue that we have detected is that very often there is a misalignment between, let's say, national policies and then those that are at the front line of this phenomenon. And therefore, one of the challenges for the insertion of migrants in the labor market is exactly the fact that until their status is not recognized and not established, they cannot have a job. And this is very much determined by the national framework. So at the stake, there are several factors. One is there is need of a work permit or residence to have a job, and this normally takes a long time, and that length is a determining factor also for the future. And the longer is the time lapse, the time gap in between the arrival and then when they get the job, the longer is a scaring effect when they enter the labor market. And very often, also country of arrival have the burden has been made more difficult by the fact that there has been period of large inflow, and so the granting of this status makes this longer, and that also creates limitation and administrative burden for which disincentivize also employers from hiring as asylum seekers. Undeclared work is also a large part of the issue. And only very, very few countries happens that as soon as asylum seekers might access the labor market as soon as they submit their application. So these are Greece and Sweden, for example, while in other countries, for example, Italy, Austria, and Germany, and Romania, there is need of a longer time to be granted permission. In other countries like Hungary, for example, and this is only once the status of refugees is recognized that they can access the labor market. You can go to the next slide. So, in essence, higher employment rates emerge. What we have also find out is higher employment rates emerge from those refugees that have had the longer stay in European country, where the language, for example, plays an important role. And the longer the refugee stays, the more they understand the local culture and the labor market. And another factor that plays a role in the insertion is also the resettling scheme within Europe. So to conclude, in essence, what is the integration, although it has been a bit too difficult to identify only policies for large work market insertion, it's because integration of migrants is a multi-dimensional intervention. We came to the conclusion that, in essence, you can go to the next slide. there is need of good practice having common free education and free language courses. For example, this is the case, for example, in Austria and in Ireland, where we detected practices, for example, in Limerick, where the university takes charge of giving free courses and very much tailored language courses to migrants. We also analyzed very interesting practices in Sweden the Södertälje and the Tegle approach is quite effective, where basically there is a mix of mentoring, but also a proper contract offered to refugees, and who works together with also local youngsters that have been unemployed for some time. Another effective practice is a fast track that is offered in France for labor insertion of refugees and asylum seekers. I conclude here.
Okay. Thank you.